Baik, kita lanjutkan ke presenter berikutnya ya. Sudah mulai menunjukkan hiper PowerPoint ini. Ada hiper PowerPoint. Kita hapus Sigma, kita lanjutkan presenter selanjutnya. Siapa yang ke bagian? Oke. Ya, silahkan. Silahkan, Yulis. Share screen untuk memaparkan presentasinya.
Baik, dok. Terima kasih.
Silahkan slideshow dan dimulai presentasinya.
Izin presentasi dalam bahasa Inggris. Good evening, Dr. Ulum and fellow friends. Today I'll be presenting about hydrosulfings in dairy coats. Hydrosulfings is an oviduct disease that can partially or fully compromise female fertility, depending upon whether the disease occurs unilaterally or bilaterally. It is characterized by a dilated lumen due to the accumulation of fluid in any of the three portions of the oviduct and may affect up to 80% of the organ. The hydrosulfings incidence rate hydrosulfing incidence rate is 1.1% in goats, which is observed in a study by Maya et al. 2018. And this was higher than the previous reports by Celta et al. 1998, which has incidence rate of 0.02 and 0.03 in a study by Bina et al. 2015. This shows the importance of accurate diagnosis as the incidence rate is increasing over the years. Infertility in hydrosulfings causes infertility in unilateral condition and sterility under bilateral conditions. This is due to distension of several parts of the oviduct leading to compromised reproductive function. By using transrectal ultrasound for the diagnosis of hydrosulfings in species that in which transrectal palpation cannot be performed, this will help ease the diagnosis of this disease. In order to have a correct ultrasound diagnosis, attention should be paid to the organs affected by hydrosulfings, which is the oviduct, hydromatra, the uterus, and follicular cysts, which occurs in the ovaries. This is because the presence of all of these three conditions seemed as either large or small and anechoica rounded structures. Yes. The etiology of this disease is not exactly known as the condition continues, but based on speculation, it is an inflammatory process after effect whereby extension of inflammatory exudates from the uterus leading to inflammation in the oviducts occurs due to hostile environment that will prevent implantation of an embryo. This disease can also be caused by congenital malformations and congenital serous secretions. Based on ultrasound, it will look like this, whereby it is characterized as a rounded and anechoic structure, the picture in figure A, formed by the accumulation of fluid in the lumen. And picture B is showing that is next to the position of it is next to the ovary, which is next to several follicles. Besides that, it can also be viewed microscopically and macroscopically. For macroscopic analysis, we have the oviduct will be seen as distended, elongated, and tortuous, forming coils in the mesocelphinx, which is due to the presence of a clear watery fluid throughout the entire length of the organ. Besides that, in the infundibulum, which is most commonly affected, it will seem as a rounded structure up to 100 millimeters in diameter. The ampulla is also the second most commonly affected region, and in the isthmus, only minor changes were observed. The oviduct with hydrocephalus does not have healthy cilia, hence embryos that find their way into the fallopian tube become trapped. And in based on the journals that I have read, all goats have adhesions between the rounded structures and ovaries. This is the microscopic view of hydrocephalus in goats. In picture A, we can see the presence of a rounded structure followed by a narrowed portion of the oviduct. And in picture B, you have segmental aplasia of the oviduct, the round circle. And in picture C is the conformation of the oviduct after the infusion of Janissen violet stain from the infundibulum to the isthmus. For microscopic analysis, there is vacuolation and basophilia at the endometrial gland cells. Flattening of the endometrial epithelium also occurs. And in the infundibulum and ampulla, a decrease and or absence of mucosal folds with subsequent reduction of epithelial surface area was verified. And specifically in the infundibulum, a high rate of nuclear extrusion was observed in epithelial cells. This is the microscopic view of the cells, whereby in picture A, we can see the vacuolation of the endometrial gland cells, the white arrows, and basophilia, which is the black arrow. Whereas in picture B, you have the right uterine. Whereas in picture B, you have the right uterine horn showing vacuolation of the endometrial cells and basophilia as well. And in picture C, you have the left horn with flattening of endometrial epithelium. And in the last picture, you have the left horn with flattened endometrial epithelium. This is also another microscopic analysis. Here we have the right ampulla, epithelium with loss of mucosal folds. And in picture B, we have the left infundibulum epithelium with similar loss of mucosal folds. And C is also, but in the left ampulla. And finally, nuclear extrusion of epithelial cells in the right infundibulum as seen in picture D. For diagnosis of this case, it's mainly focused on affected organs. Like, we have to pay attention in checking all the affected organs. So for the oviduct, we check that there is hydrocephalus, and then in the uterus, is checked for hydrometra, and in the ovaries for folliculosis. The uterus is fully evaluated by checking the presence of liquid and or concept of the appearance. In the ovaries, is evaluated for verification of follicles, corpus luteum, and possible cysts. The oviduct is only visible if it has pathological alterations. Usually, we cannot really palpate this. If we are unsure whether it is between these three diseases, then ultrasound should be repeated after treatment with PGF2 alpha for hydrometra and GnRH for folliculosis. The affected part Generally, how it will look like is that the affected part is dilated and its lumen contains a turbid fluid and the walls are very thin and transparent. This is the ultrasound comparison between the three diseases. In figure A, in all figures, we basically see an anechoic rounded structure. But for the first one, we see hydrosalpinx, which is marked by which is an echoic rounded structure with acoustic reinforcement on the bottom of the structure. And in B, we have severe hydromatra containing large anechoic segments. And in C, we have ovarian folliculosis. Okay, as for treatment may not be useful and prevention is more advantageous. If both oviducts are involved, then the animal will become completely sterile and has to be culled. Overall prognosis in affections of the oviduct has usually been unfavorable except in mild infections. And parenteral as well as intrauterine infusion of broad spectrum antibiotics may or may not be beneficial. Gentle handling of genitalia, proper treatment, control of uterine infections and sexual rest can reduce the incidence of infections of the oviduct. And oviduct surgeries described for human females such as salpingostomy and salpingectomy are neither mentioned for most domestic animals. In conclusion, hydrosalpinx may be successfully diagnosed in goats by transrectal ultrasound after differentiating the diagnosis from other conditions such as hydromatra and folliculosis. The relatively high occurrence of hydrosalpinx reported in studies reveals the importance of accurate diagnosis of the disease, and hydrosalpinx is an important cause of reproductive failure in nulliparous goats that may stay in the herd for 2 years or more without producing offsprings and milk. These are the references that I used. Thank you.
Oke, baik. Terima kasih. Silahkan pertanyaan.
Hikmah, dokter ya, ingin bertanya. Bagaimana mekanisme penyebab hingga terjadinya hidrosalpinx? Kalau tidak salah, tadi saya tidak ada pemaparan dari sana. Bisa dijelaskan?
Ya, baik. Terima kasih, Hikmah. Untuk mekanismenya, sebenarnya sampai hari ini sebab untuk kasus ini tidak ada banyak penelitian dalam kambing. Jadi untuk mekanismenya belum fully diketahui. Tapi sejauh ini yang dispekulasi itu mekanismenya kasus ini bisa affect the gametes and fertilization to lowering endometrial receptivity. Bisa mempengaruhi gamet dan fertilisasi hingga menurunkan endometrial receptivity. Resensitif lupa apa bahasa Indonesia. Selain itu, kalau hydrosalpinx, okay. Besides that, if hydrosalpinx occurs unilaterally, that means only on one oviduct, then it will result in infertility. Whereas if it affects both, then it will, that means bilaterally, it will result in sterility.
Gimana? Resistivity maksudnya ya? Apa? Resistant? Hambatan?
No, receptivity. Hold on. Bentar ya dok, saya...
Keberterimaan reseptor.
Iya.
Resep. Oke. Okay. Mana Hikmah?
Daya penerimaan. Kesediaan menerima? Iya.
Iya, iya. Oke, okay, thank you, Yulisa.
Others, any question? Ada tak?
Izin bertanya, dokter.
Yes, silakan.
Apakah pada kasus yang dengan hidrometra atau tidak? Terima kasih.
Maaf.
Soalnya terputus, Sabdi. Diulang lagi yang apa dari awal.
Ya, izin bertanya, apakah kejadian hidrosalving ini dapat terjadi secara bersamaan dengan hidrometra? Terima kasih.
Ya, bisa. Sebenarnya hidrosalving ini susah di... I'm just going to answer in English, sorry. Yes, it can happen together with hydrometra. Usually this hydrosalving, it's very hard to diagnose because it usually occurs with other reproductive disorders such as hydrometra and follicular cyst. And because it is a accumulation of fluid which is similar to hydrometra and follicular cyst, that's why it makes it hard to diagnose because they all look the same. In most cases, so far, based on what I've read, it usually comes after hydrometra. It's not explained why, but basically to answer your question, yes, it can occur with hydrometra.
Gimana? Oke. Okay.
Ya, dokter. Sudah, terima kasih.
Sudah, kan satu saluran ya itu. One channel. Oke, lanjut. Next presentation. Kita hapus. Kita lanjutkan. Adil, ini silahkan.
Jadi yang share screen saya, dok.
Iya, nanti biar nggak ngobrol sendiri gitu, padahal sudah terkick off. Silahkan di full screen dan dimulai diulang lagi ya, Dil. Silahkan.
Baik, dokter. Terima kasih atas kesempatannya. Pertama-tama, selamat sore ke teman-teman semua. Perkenalkan, saya Kadila Effendi, NIM B94-2021-49. Akan melaporkan studi kasus tentang sel transisi karsinoma yang melibatkan duktus defense pada anjing yang dibimbing oleh Dr. Hewan Muhammad Farul Ulum, MSI, PhD. Saya mengambil jurnal dari Guerin et al. 2012, yaitu Transitional Cell Carcinoma Involving the Ductus Deferens in Dog. Anamnesa dan sinyalmen, anjing dengan ras Springer Spaniel dengan jenis kelamin jantan, usia 12 tahun dengan gejala klinis, nafas bau urea, prostat keras, dan hematuria, dan dengan histori telah dikastrasi dan memiliki riwayat urolitiasis, sudah dilakukan pengobatan terapi pemberian antibiotik berdasarkan kultur bakteri yang ditemukan selama 1 tahun, setelah pemberian obat dihentikan, gejala klinis terlihat kembali. Karsinoma sel transisi atau biasa disebut dengan karsinoma urolisial merupakan jenis sel tumor dari jaringan epitel transisional yang melapisi permukaan bagian saluran kemih. Fulkerson dan Knapp 2015. Adapun dari kausa dari kasus ini yaitu gen, lingkungan, lawan chemicals, overdose cyclophosphamide, obesitas, infeksi pada bladder dan post kastrasi. Selanjutnya adalah patogenesa. Pada kasus ini, setelah dilakukan kastrasi, terdapat kecurigaan terjadinya inflamasi, aplasia segmental, dan neoplasia. ductus deferens dilapisi oleh sel epitel kolumnar semu, sedangkan pada bladder, prostat, dan uretra dilapisi oleh sel epitel transisional. Transisional sel karsinoma atau TCC tidak bisa menjadi tumor primer pada ductus deferens, tetapi ada kemungkinan bahwa proliferasi lokal dari tumor prostat mengakibatkan invasi tumor pada ductus deferens karena adanya hubungan secara anatomi antara prostat dengan ductus deferens. Lalu tekanan dari uretra pada saat urinasi juga merupakan spekulasi terjadinya TCC pada ductus deferens karena peningkatan tekanan saat mengejan akan mengakibatkan urin terdorong ke ductus deferens. Next. Selanjutnya adalah temuan klinis pada kasus ini. Pada pemeriksaan USG ditemukan cairan pada bagian dorsal kandung kemih yang memanjang dari bagian midline, bladder sampai ke prostat. Lalu ditemukan mineral heterogenus pada parenkim prostat. Lalu di dinding kandung kemih menebal dan tidak teratur, terutama pada leher kandung kemih. Dan ada catatan bahwa karena ductus deferens yang normal jarang terlihat pada saat melakukan ultrasonografi pada abdomen anjing, identifikasi struktur tubular berisi cairan di dorsal kandung kemih menunjukkan terjadinya abnormalitas pada ductus deferens. Lalu pada hasil biopsi berupa histopatologi, dari hasil laporan terjadi abnormalitas ductus deferens pada bagian kanan. Lalu pada lumen dilapisi dengan epitel transisional yang tidak teratur. Lalu beberapa sarang sel neoplastik terlihat di prostat dan menunjukkan pola yang invasif. Lalu aktivitas sel melakukan mitosis tinggi dan ditemukan nuclear polymorphism. Dapat dilihat pada gambar B. Selanjutnya. Analisis biokimia dari penelitian ini didapatkan kadar urea 19,1 mmol per L, yaitu normalnya 2,5 sampai 9,6 mmol per L. Lalu pada culture bakteri yang tumbuh, yaitu bakteri gram negatif, kadar WBC sedikit meningkat 5 sampai 10 WBC per HPF. Lalu pada kadar RBC itu meningkat 50 sampai 100 RBC per HPF. Dan ditemukan debris epithelial cells pada endapan urin. Diferensial diagnosa dari kasus ini berupa hidrouretar, ureterokol, kista paraprostatik, pseudohemaprodite, dilatasi ductus deferens. Treatment berdasarkan jurnal, yaitu dengan surgery removal, yaitu pengangkatan tumor, dengan metode operasi laparotomi medianus, dan pada metode tersebut diangkat bagian ductus deferens sebelah kanan karena di ductus karena dari hasil uji lab dan hasil dari anamnesa sebelumnya ditemukan tumor TCC ini pada ductus deferens sebelah kanan. Lalu lalu diberikan obat meloxicam dengan dosis 0,1 mg per kilogram sebelum anjing tersebut di eutanasia. Lalu ada pun treatment yang disarankan oleh Fulkerson dan Knapp, yaitu terapi radiasi, medical therapy berupa kemoterapi, dan intravesikal therapy. Terima kasih. Mungkin saya kembalikan ke Dr. Ulum.
Silakan, pertanyaan buat Dila.
Mau izin bertanya, dokter. Ya. Tadi disebutkan dari pemaparannya Didi, kalau bakteri yang ditemukan di kultur itu bakteri gram negatif kan ya. Terus treatmentnya sendiri juga pakai meloxicam. Apakah ada penelitian atau secara lanjutan untuk mendapatkan bakteri spesifiknya itu apa ya gitu? Dan dari jurnal atau kasus yang Didi ambil itu kira-kira bakteri spesifik yang menyebabkannya apa ya, kalau boleh tahu? Terima kasih.
Baik, terima kasih Dina atas pertanyaannya. Dari bacaan yang saya baca atau dari jurnal studi kasus yang saya baca itu, bakteri yang umum ditemukan pada kasus pada kasus ini, pada kasus yang disebutkan yaitu bakteri Escherichia coli. Kita tahu bahwa bakteri E. coli itu sangat umum ditemukan pada pada jaringan atau organ yang telah mengalami inflamasi. Jadi semakin parah inflamasi, maka kultur dari atau pertumbuhan dari bakteri tersebut juga ikut tumbuh. Itu yang lebih dominan, tapi ditemukan juga bakteri lain seperti Streptococcus dan yang lainnya seperti itu.
Baik, terima kasih Didi.
Baik, terima kasih. Masih ada? Cukup.